So it's a pleasure for us to receive here Isaque Sanches for another The Arts and Crafts of Game Programming session, the 10th. Okay, so thank you.
Thank you.
Looking forward to listening to your presentation. But this is a double session, so.
Okay, thank you once again for being here with us and sharing your experience with our students. So this is one of the first mixed, let's say, or double sessions together with the Games and Apps course with the Master Interaction Design. And we have here all our students from both courses and even other invited distinguished attendees which are with us. And so I thank you in name of Yad for being here with us. And I hope you enjoy the session and put some interesting questions and ask everything you think it could be helpful for your studies, and enjoy. Thank you.
Thanks, the pleasure is mine.
The floor is yours.
Okay. So let's begin this. So the title of this presentation is What is Digital Handicraft? So it's a bit of a wordplay, right? Because when you think about handicraft, you think about physical stuff, and there's the digital aspect of it, and that's a term that I rarely hear, but I think it's very appropriate, and I'm going to talk to you about that. Before that, if you like this talk, be sure to follow me on social media. Okay, this is my Facebook and my Twitter. Okay, so let's begin. Are games art? This is a very frequent question in the games industry, and not only in the games industry. And I think this question is less important than another one, which is this question pointless? Okay, like the question of are games art or are games not art is part of a discussion that makes no sense in the context of reality, because when you think about it, these are two extremes, right? When you think about function and engineering, right, this is one extreme and the other is artistry. The real world, you see everything that you see is in between. That's what we call handicraft. For instance, is this chair art or is this chair a tool, right? You can't, like, there's this extreme where you go to with the thing of the authorship and the expression and the idea and the vision, and then you have this other really other point, really extremely, really the polar opposite of this idea, which is I'm building a tool, there's a function for that, but in the real world, everything, most of the things that we see, they don't conform into those two categories. So how pointless really is the question? How useful is asking, are games art or are games not art? Are they design? Are they like a form of expression? How pointless is that? Let's take this as an example. Like, this is absolutely pointless also. This is art, like most people would agree. But it serves no function, right? It has no meaning. I mean, it could have a meaning, but from a perspective of usability, you cannot use this. This is really, it has no function. But a chair has a function, right? And this is not, a chair has a function. We would say that this is design and this is art. Sorry, I'm not used to that. And we would say that this is art and this is design, right? But the reality is that art, actually, when you look at it, it also has a function. This is expressing something. It is expressing an idea, and it has a social mission in a way. And you can also see that tools can have some artistry, right? They can have some creative value, some expressive value. So the reality is that when you look at everything, everything is blurred. It's not this black or white thing. And when you look at games and interactive experiences, taking this false dichotomy, this is this black or is this white? Is this A or is this B? There's so many letters in the abecedary, I don't know how you say it in English. Take that as an example. Is this useful? No. Is it art? Most people wouldn't say that it's art. It has no author, right? It has no meaning. It has no creative vision. We call that handiwork. And this is, I think, the appropriate word we should use for games. Are they art? Are they not? They're handiwork. Handicraft, right? They're digital handicraft. And you can see digital handicraft everywhere. You could see it here, okay? For instance, in movies, in CGI, CGI rendering. You could see it in tech demos. This is taken from a tech demo. It's not a game, but it's used for real-time rendering. But let's go back a bit. A chair, as you see, as you've seen this chair, it has a function, right? But there's all types of chairs. You can make all types of creative, pointlessly creative nuances to that chair. You can make it without arms, with arms. You can make it solid. You can make it a bit more soft. And this is Antonio Gaudi. If you are from design, you recognize this man. He was an architect, and he was also a designer. And this is an architecture, is that middle ground between function and usability and pointlessness. And you can see that it is, in fact, a chair, and it's a collection, in a way, a chair and a mirror. But they are not a collection in, they wouldn't be in a museum, right? But they have some artistry, right? And this is the paradigm that we should use with this, which is, yeah, this is taken from a game, okay? We can build models, we can build real-time rendering, but this is also a world, and it's pointlessly a world. It could be, this is a first-person shooter, it has a lot of story in it, it has a lot of mechanics and whatnot. The game is about shooting people, but they've built everything around it, like a chair. A chair is about sitting. You build a chair in order to sit. But you can make it a bit more twisted. You can make some nuances. You can make a lot of things around the chair. And this is a game about shooting people. And yet, you see that statue. Why is that statue there, right? It's not about that paradigm of they are authors and they want to express that statement. It's just as it is. You can see it in music as well, like digital handicraft. You can see it in 3D modeling. It's also a way of doing digital handicraft. But the thing I wanted to focus here is on in the potential and the real difference between digital handicraft and real world handicraft or material handicraft. So the potential here, as you can see, like you could build this out of wood. It would be a model like a statue, a figurine. You've seen like that bicycle, right? It's mostly the same thing, but you can also do this, which is procedural generation. So there's a bit of difference, and at first you would see that, yeah, it's not that different. You can take that model and you can add some random elements to it. This is not a model, but it's abstract art made from generative software, okay? And you'd see that, yeah, it's not that big of a deal at first sight. It looks interesting, and you can do all sorts of abstract, strange stuff, like this, for instance. But the thing is, and let me just fast forward a bit. You can also use it to build real things. You can model it the same way that you saw the ship. This artist, which is Seamus Young, he could have done a city. This is a pixel city, a project that he did for university. And basically, it's a random generation of software of cities, right? He could have done a city, he could have modeled that city, but he decided to do a software that would build that city. And there's a bit of a difference. You can see it in this video, okay? This city actually can be infinite, and there are obviously not infinite combinations, and maybe there is, I don't know, I didn't read the paper, but there's something about this, right, which is, if he did a city, that city would be that city. By building that software, he didn't build one city, he didn't build two cities, he built infinite cities. Every combination is actually what he did. He could have applied those hours into building that model. Instead, he applied those hours into building an algorithm. And by doing so, he created infinite cities. He created a city that is not a physical thing, but a multidimensional thing. And this is, I think, the power of random or generative art. Okay, you can see it in games, for instance. Sorry, this is very messed up. You can see it in games. Really sorry. Maybe I'm going here. Okay, you can see. Okay, I'm really sorry. You can see it in games. This is AudioSurf. Okay, AudioSurf is a game that when you think about Pixar, they think of a storyboard. Okay, and they make music around the storyboard, and they as they develop the movie. So they make CGI, they model it, they try to new rendering techniques. Okay, and they make sound around it. This is the same concept in reverse. You could do the same thing. You could have, and in a way, that's what dancing is. When you build a choreography, you have sound, and then you try to put image or form or movement around it. This is exactly what this man did when he built AudioSurf. This is the second one. You take an MP3 file or any sort of audio file, and then it builds like a sort of a roller coaster around it, a structure around that file. So he could have done that for one music, and it would have made sense. But he decided to do generative ads, or in a way, a random generation, not random, but procedural generation. So he built a thing that makes sense for any music. Actually, he built every music possible in this game. And this is the power of it. Another example would be, and this is a bit obscure, like this is not the best examples for, I chose the most obscure ones, but there's a lot of stuff on procedural generation, and there's a lot of games, especially on games. But this is a game about being hunted in a map. But the maps are always different. So the game works in a way you never know how to hide, where to hide. And this is another way of using procedural. In this game, and this game is really, I'm really sorry about the video, maybe you're not gonna see it well because it's very hard to see. This game is not about changing the object, but changing how you see the object. So this artist tried to make a game shader built upon noise. Okay, so he made something that looks like this. And this is very confusing if you're not playing it, but as you're playing it, it makes a lot of sense. But as you can see, it's not about the environment itself, it's how you perceive the environment. It's actually very bad in this video, but it's also fine-tuned that it's on the edge of comprehension when you're playing it, so taking a video out of context, it's a bit below the edge, but you can sort of see a bit of 3D here, of dimensionality. But let's just speak about something even simpler. Solitaire, right? When you play solitaire, when you win, the creator wanted you to present you with something, to give you a present, right? So you win, and then it does procedural generation. And it's very, you can see that it's random, in the sense that this is one way, right? But you could, the algorithm could make something else. And the argument here is that every scenario here is part of the creation, right? He made all of that possible. But you could see that classic solitaire is very old in a way, and you could see it as one of the first examples of procedural generation. It's It's since the beginning of digital, and even before digital, procedural was a thing. If you research surrealism, the beginning of surrealism, they did a lot of experiments with automation. For instance, you'd close your eyes and you'd just do things, or like when you took a sheet of paper and you folded it, and you gave someone the bottom, and then someone the head, and someone the middle, and then you'd open, and you'd generate a sort of drawing that was very surreal in a way. But it didn't begin like with solitaire, and it certainly won't end in the near future. I think there's a lot of possibility here, and I think I'm not the only one to think that. But imagine, for instance, a thing about design. Handicraft is about taking something like this and making it like this, right? Decorating, this is pointless, right? You could have a plate that is just white, but you can decorate it in that way. But when you take handicraft to, let me just give you another example. They're like two knives. This knife is a tool, and this knife is a tool, but it has some artistry in it. Taking that to the digital and taking that to generative art, this is actually the potential, which is a knife is not a knife. It can also be a fork, but it can also be a spoon. And actually, that knife is not a knife. It's the three at the same time, right? And when you take examples like Minecraft has a procedural element to it. It builds worlds. And all those worlds are unique in a way. They are random. But if you didn't say that to a person who never knew Minecraft, and you said, this is a game, like this is the mechanics, this is how you navigate, and the person didn't know what it was, didn't know it was random, and the person would ask, who built that? What would you answer? You'd answer the creator, in this case, Notch. The Notch made this game. And if you ran the game again and it made another level, the person would ask, who made that level also? It would be Notch. So Notch built those two levels. Actually, he built those two and the other one and all the possible levels. As he was programming, he wasn't modeling, he wasn't painting, he wasn't using Photoshop or anything. As he was programming, he was building worlds. And this is the potential. But let me go on a tangent here and talk about intertextuality. Okay, and I'm going to come back to this and explain what I mean with this tangent. Okay, so this is The Fountain by Marcel Duchamp. And this is the reductio at Hitlerum of the art discussions. I don't know if you know the term reduction at Hitlerum, but it's basically when you have no arguments on either side, you go and use Hitler as an argument. For instance, oh, that's worse than Hitler, or Hitler was also vegetarian, for instance. Like you have no arguments and you go there. So when you are discussing art and you have also no arguments on either side, you always go to this specific art piece, which was done by Marcel Duchamp. Marcel Duchamp took an urinal and he presented it as an art piece. And I had this argument between, I wasn't part of the argument, but I was watching. It was between an artist and a programmer. An artist, like that's what we call in the jargon of the game industry, but it was a visual artisan, right? It was a programmer artist, and the programmer would say, this has no meaning. It doesn't mean anything. It's just an urinal. You are reading too much into it. You are turning this into a sort of elite whatever. And he was saying, no, it has a lot of context, it has a lot of meaning, it has vision. And he was saying, how can it have meaning? It's a urinal, for God's sake. It's just a urinal. And I was watching it. And then this came up which is blue monochrome, which is also another of these type of examples, which is a painting that is only blue, right? And he was saying, oh, this is impossible. This painting by Klein has no meaning. It cannot have any meaning. And the other was saying, no, it has a lot of meaning. It's very expressive. It makes no sense, was saying the programmer. And I tried to bridge those two and make them understand that they were, in a way, both right. Okay, and this is what I did. I went to the artist, and I told him that the programmer was a programmer. In university, he learned about bits and bytes. He learned about information theory. He learned about entropy, information entropy. So when he saw this image, he actually saw this image, but in high resolution. So he would see this is green, this is orange, this is red. And he would see that as a map, right? This is this number of information. In high resolution, it has more information. Therefore, it has more meaning. But in a way, it's a bit like this, but on a large scale. This is blue, this is red, this is yellow. And it's information, right? You can also make it by types. So this is type A, type B, type C. And this is how he was saying, seeing it. And even here, this would have more information than the other painting because, again, there's three types. And you see one, two, three. And you see an arrangement of those types. But here, this is one bit. It has nothing. This is what I was trying to make him understand. This is only one giant pixel. It has nothing. How can you encrypt any sort of meaning into this? And then the artist was, I didn't think about that. And then I went to the programmer, and I asked him, I wrote toilets on a piece of paper, and I asked him if he recognized the word and what that word meant. And he said, this is a toilet. Okay. And what if I say WC? It's not toilet, right? But you can still recognize it, right? It's the same information, but with less letters, right? And what if I just drew this? You can still understand that it's a bathroom, right? You can see still understand what it is. What if I said I need help? You understand it, but if I said SOS, it's just three letters, and yet you still understand it. And what if I do this? This is SOS in Morse code. So this is only two bits, right? And then I was saying, like, actually, what it is this is a shape, a black shape in a white shape, right? How can this have any meaning or more meaning? Actually, how can you encapsulate or how can you reduce the concept of help, which is such or need, which is such a complex concept? How can you make that into black and white? How can you make that into a shape? This is as preposterous as this. And then I showed him this, and this is actually a real kanji, but this is just gibberish. I showed him this, and I asked him, what's the meaning of this? Does this have any meaning? Is this anything? Or is this just black and white? Is this just forms? And I said, I need help the same way that I had bathroom in a symbol or in a kanji. I could have said, actually, I need help is this shape, okay? In some language I invented, because like Morse code, someone invented that. Some people know that. Some other people don't know that. Maybe in the future, nobody understands Morse code. But today, we understand. If I showed him this picture, would this be a character in my language? Would this mean anything? And then I said, if I have this, why can it be a physical chair, right? Can a physical chair, because a piece of paper is a message, why can't a physical chair be a message? And then I pointed to the pen. Why isn't this pen text? Why isn't this pen a sentence? Why isn't this pen a poem? Why isn't this pen like the Lusíadas encapsulated in just a pen? The thing is, nothing has inherent meaning. We attribute meaning to things, but they have no actual meaning. We just say, this correlates to this. This element means this. But a chair is a chair, and a paper is a paper, and ink is ink. So why is this a poem? Why could this be a poem or mean anything that we wanted and not this? And this is what the point I was making, and I was saying, like, the thing is that you see this as a function and from an engineering perspective, and you see this as an artist perspective. Art is about trying to establish a paradigm and a language, just like Morse code. And just because you don't understand the language doesn't mean that it has no meaning. And then he said, oh. So this is the thing about intertextuality. So when we think about the classical, I don't know, part of you have studied this, I guess, the classical examples of game design. You have, for instance, Pac-Man, and we talk a lot about the excellence of why that game design is good or why it's not. The early games that have built like this industry didn't rely on manuals, and you could play instantly and learn. Supposedly, that's what I learned in my game design courses. And you can see here, like, if you don't know, for instance, this is a ghost, and for a Western society, a ghost is a bad thing. And you can see here, these are your lives. So every time you die, this one disappears. But you can also see that this is the same thing, right? So you can correlate, and you can see that you are supposed to eat the fruit because we are humans and we like fruit. So we use visual metaphors. So as you play, it's very obvious. And whenever you first play the game, it moves in one direction. You are forced to move in one direction, and you understand immediately that you are eating the little points. So the game is built for visual metaphor, and this is a classical example as well. Not this one, but all the Mario series is about this. For those who don't know what I'm talking about, this is a pit. Everybody has fear of heights, in a way. You see a bottomless pit and you understand that it's danger. You see this, for instance, if you see this little shade, you understand there's volume, and it looks like a chimney in a way, or a tube, or whatever, and you understand, even in black and white, this is why I chose this one, you understand that this is only a background, and whenever you start the level, the character is on the left side of the screen, so to us who read from left to right, it makes sense that it goes in that way. So this is what I learned. But then I thought about football. Everything that I learned about game design in that aspect made no sense. Why is football, if those aspects, the richness of those metaphors, of that language, is actually what made those games successful, why is football successful? I mean, how do you teach a player how to play, or what what it's saying about the other people playing? How do you teach that? Supposedly, you make the game easy to understand, you use metaphors, but here, how do you know what's a goal? How do you know what's a penalty? But it's everything else is arbitrary. And if you go to other examples of games that are as successful, if you go to the American roulette, what is this? Like, if you don't know anything about the game, this is just a table of numbers. Yet, it's a very successful and lucrative game. It's ageless. How do you learn that? How does that become popular? This was something that was not right in my mind, and I didn't knew how to connect the two. And then I played this. So I was at a Nordic Game Jam, and there was this crowd that told me, go play that game. And I went, and it was a cell phone. I took the cell phone. It has some instructions and some photos. I didn't get it. I left it there. Then, just like 2 minutes after I did that, a group comes, and one says to the other, oh, you have to play this. It's amazing. He takes the phone. He takes a selfie. And then he passes to the other guy. And then the other guy, as I was seeing, I was thinking, the game is brilliant. Basically, it's very simple. It's a game that has a library of images, okay? And it chooses a random, speaking of randomness, it chooses a random image, and then you have to make the same face as the image that you're seeing. And then it chooses other three pictures, and it compares other five, and it compares them and shows like the person only sees the your selfie, not the original photo, and then he has to guess which one did you imitate. It's very simple. As you play, the library increases because you take more selfies. And the thing is, it's very different in a way. It's very simple, but it's stupidly simple. I didn't get it at first. I needed to see other people play it, and that's an element. That's an epiphany I had. Also, when I at the Global Game Jam this year, I made a game that is about I'm not talking about that game, but I usually experiment on game design, and essentially the reaction is mostly or I don't get it. And in this case, there was a huge crowd that was always wanted to play the game, and it didn't make sense to me. Why is this game like? Of course, there's some merit in like there's points and whatever. But the thing is, why is this game captivating and not that one? That was something that didn't also connect in my mind. Then everything connected. This game was an interesting story. I was prototyping in a jam, and the jam was divided in rooms. And as I was building the game, I was asking people to test it. And the people tested it, and they watched me play first because it wasn't ready, and then they played, and then they got it. And then as the game was ready, I asked everybody again, and they were playing, and the other people were coming, and they were seeing the room playing, and they would just sit and watch. And then as the other guys stopped playing, they would sit and play as well, and they would say, oh, this is really, really awesome. But then this is an event we did afterwards. There were people that didn't see, when there was no group, people just sat there, and they didn't get the game. But whenever there was a huge group, everybody in the group got it. So I think that football, if you will, is a nice example of learning through mimicry, right? Learning through social interaction. The same way that I learned how to play that selfie game through mimicry. And when you think about it, Tetris is also a classical game and a successful game. This is incomprehensible to anyone who hasn't played it. This is not intuitive. What is the visual metaphor? And when I think about like the early games that built this industry, the classical games, the classical genres, you can see that a lot of that was social interaction. Like everything was obvious when you had a group of friends. And this is how, in my opinion, how you tell mechanics, right? This is, forget language and try to build your own. I mean, how far, you know that visual metaphors work, but you don't know how much, right? How can you study that? We are surrounded by this language already. You don't know the impact this language has. Like, you would play a first-person game, and you already know this is the key to run, this is the key to shoot, like, because they are all the same. But if you give the controller to a non-gamer and he doesn't understand, because you already have this language in your head, how can you measure the impact of, for new genres, how can you measure the impact of visual metaphor? Maybe it's all about sharing the experience, right? I don't know, but I mean, this works. So forget, I think like forgetting about usability when designing something can be good. I'm not saying that it's necessarily good, but this was the tangent I was going to make. And now we're gonna talk about Only God Forgives. Before that, color coding. Everything in media uses color coding in some way or another. This is a game, like in interactive media, games are very powerful examples. So I'm focusing mostly on games, but here you can see that we're using color for UI. Okay, this is nothing special. Here we are using color for mechanics. Okay, this is a part of the gameplay. It's about color is about the mechanics and interacting with the world. Okay, let me just skip that. Okay, here you are using colors for world building. As you can see, the foreground is much darker than the background. Okay, and then you know what's interactive and what's not, but you also know what's part of the scenery and what's part of what's really near you. And this is a nicer example, which is this tree, as you can see, is gray, okay, but the branches which are interactable and which are part of the real world that you're seeing and that you can interact with, they are darker. So this is the use of color coding for another purpose. And you can actually get into the more nuanced thing, which is, this is mirror's edge. Every element that is interactable is red. You can turn that off, but in the main game, how you're supposed to play the experience, that's what the authors wanted. Even your hands, this is a parkour game, so you are always climbing stuff. Your hands are red, the elements that you touch are red. Is this mechanic, is this world building? It's a bit of both, okay? And let's go into Only God Forgives. Only God Forgives is a boring movie, okay? I didn't enjoy the movie, but I was watching it drunk, so maybe when the first time I watched the movie, I understood something that I've tried to research on Google and nobody talks about it, which is the color coding of the movie. So most of the movie is either in shades of blue, red, or yellow, okay? And as I was seeing the movie, maybe because I was drunk, I was starting to see theme in the colors. So red was, I don't remember, but imagine, let's say, for example, red was anger, and blue was envy, and yellow was insecurity, something like that. And the nice thing about this is that when, and the reason why they're primary colors is when you combine them, you can sort of mix feelings into one frame, okay? You can actually build an emotional landscape just with colors. And you can, this is like how you establish language, and this is why we did the tangent about intertextuality, is always about the obviousness, but also about what you choose and what the context that you choose. So imagine I want to say duplicity or duality, or the number two. I use two persons, okay, like two contrasting persons, or I can use a mirror, okay. The movies love mirrors, I don't know why, but it's about like the inner world versus the external or something like that. But you can see that you duplicate an image and then it becomes duplicity or duality. You can use it in comic books as well. For instance, this is Watchmen. This character is called Rorschach. His mask is a Rorschach test. So symmetry here is used as a way to convey duplicity. And we could use it in games like as two play styles, okay? Like two archetypes, two ways of seeing the world, two main personalities, if you will. It could also be two love interests, okay? It could also be two doors representing two choices. You can say two in many ways, okay? And but the thing is, and the problem with this approach is that, imagine, for instance, Only God Forgives. Red, let's say, means envy, and blue means insecurity, okay? Why does blue mean insecurity, right? Why does red means envy? Why can't it be, like, we are talking about colors or we are talking about feelings? As we take this example, why is left red and right blue? Why can't it be, I got ahead of myself, but forget that. Another tangent. You have two doors, right? Why two doors? Let's ask this question first. You can have two of anything in a game. In a game or in any digital media, it's very easy. You copy and paste, right? You could have two enemies, two other enemies. You could have infinite everything because everything is copy and pasted when you have built it. Two could also be two lamps. You could do anything with that. It could also be, if I wanted to say four, I could do four lamps. If I wanted to say 10, I could say 10 lands. And admitting that there's no language barrier, okay, that people always understood what I wanted to say with the artwork I'm doing, I could say that 5 is 5 lamps, right? There's 10 lamps, and those 5 are I light up. But I could also say that those 5 lamps could be arranged like this, right? Why like that and not like this? And why like that at all? Why not like this? And why not like this, right? This has some symmetry and whatever, but when you're building a movie or a comic book or even a game, for the most part, with a non-generative approach, you have to choose the elements and the context of the elements, right? You have to choose, is this like this or is this like this, okay? But it could be any sort of arrangement. If you want to say the number 5, why not use randomness? Why not do this when you run your move, when you play your movie or a comic or whatever, and sometimes this, and sometimes this, and sometimes this, and sometimes this. Actually, you are using every possibility to say 5. You are using only the lamps and not an arrangement, a specific arrangement. You are not the slave of your context. So 5 is all the possible combinations, but it could also be something else. Why say 5 and not say odd number, okay? So you take these lamps, okay, and through random generation, sometimes it's 1, sometimes it's 3, for instance, sometimes it's 4, and sometimes it's 7, sometimes it's 9. So, and randomly, you could convey through the meta-narrative, through every possible outcome of your algorithm, you could convey such an abstract concept as odd number. I mean, 5 is abstract, but odd number, right? You could do that just through procedural generation with probability. And it could be 3 like this, but it also could be 3 like this, and you can also add another element. So you are actually saying it as you want it. But 5, as you can see here, is the same frame that I showed you before. So in this run, I used 5 to say odd number, okay? So 5 can also mean odd number. I can use just one frame, one instance, to speak in that instance about a general architecture that means odd. But also, I could say that 5 is the last one, okay? Like the last position, the fifth position is 5. I could also say that 5 is all the 4 lamps turned on and not that one. Actually, I could say anything that I wanted. As I said, a pen can be a poem. Anything that, if I wanted to say that this is 5, it would be valid. So if we apply, for instance, a random generation algorithm, or a random algorithm, we could say, and this is not correct, this is the right thing, which is pick a number between 1 and 5, okay. I could say that this is 5, sorry, this is 5, this is 5, this is 5, and this is also 5. If I took, imagine you are in a game editor and you have this lamp asset, okay. You have a function and you say, instantiate this asset between 1 and 5 random times, okay? Now that you are seeing this lamp, you are saying, okay, I don't understand it. You play again, and now it's 4. And then you play again, and it's 1. And you play again, and it's 2, right? And as you see that, how many can it be? And then you reach like this limit, and you understand, it only goes to 5, so this must mean 5. It is also a way of expressing something. But in this case, as you've seen, this is 4 lamps, and it actually means that 4 equals 5. You can say all sorts of things, very weird things, through procedural generation. And this is very abstract, but let's take it back to Only God Forgives. Can we say that with color? For instance, something a bit more tangible. Let's say this is Stanley's parable again. Red door means left. right door means blue. Why can this? Why does this have to be like this? And as I was saying, you can switch both. It can be sometimes it's one, sometimes it's another. And red doesn't mean that specifically. It means anything. Red is nothing. What you're talking about, the choice itself. You could also say that you are using RGB random. So sometimes all the left choices are this color, and all the left choices are that color. But the other are another set of colors. Every time that you run, you're not a slave to the to a context. You're just transmitting an abstract idea. So when you are running this movie, this could be envy. But next time you play it, this could be envy. And the text wouldn't be lost as long as you were consistent. And here, you wouldn't be speaking about red or blue or whatever. You would be speaking about only emotions. It could be this as well. And in a way, I was speaking about automation with surrealism. This is actually what Alan Moore did with Watchmen in that character. Every time that he drew so we wouldn't be fixed on a specific shape, it drew that character, it would be a different shape. Every frame that you read every page that you read the character is a different shape. But why specifically those shapes that are invented? Why not an algorithm? Why not procedural? That way, the meaning would never be the shapes itself. It would only be the duality or the psychological aspect. So, human beings. What is randomness? Taking back to the random generation, and like I'm going to bridge those two things into one thing. Randomness, or pseudo-randomness, if you will, is the idea that you don't understand what's going to come. You actually cannot predict something. Imagine a dice. A dice is random, but if you were to see every physical intricacy of it, it would not be random. You can it's physical, it's causal, so you can predict it. But because you don't understand it, it becomes random. You don't know how it behaves. This is the definition of pseudo-random. Random supposedly is absolutely like this. It's absolutely unpredictable. But let's say everything is pseudo-random, whatever. But take free will. Is free will random or pseudo-random? Are human beings completely, are they absolutely random, or are they consistent? Are they, in a way, do they have tendencies? We could make the argument for both. Everybody can choose everything they want. But if you see like a player, he will, for instance, this is Journey. This is a technique of game design. You make a big monument or tower or whatever in the end of your game world, and then the player will always, frequently and maybe always, will follow that landmark. If you test the journey, everybody will go in that direction. So are they really truly random? Are people really random or pseudo-random? Are they predictable? Or are they not predictable? And this is the main question here, which is, can we use human beings as random generators? Instead of mathematical functions, can we use users as random generation? Can interaction be considered generative art? And this is a bit of a cop-out, and it's a bit of cheating, in a way, because let's see this example. This is a game in which you make poetry, right? And I wouldn't say this is random generation. You could say it, but if you say that's random generation, then everything is basically random generation. But there's also this game here, which is about two players constructing a narrative with a set of tools, like they're playing in a digital space. Is this really, like, is this what I was meaning by, instead of using mat.random, using players? No, this is more like it. This is a game in which you enter any enemy and change its behavior, and inside that enemy is another world, and then inside that world are other enemies, and you can enter infinitely. And so through behavior, to the human behavior, you are actually building random worlds, but that's actually not also the real deal. To me, the real deal is this, or it could be this. This is the unfinished one, okay? And the mechanic here is that you cannot see anything and you need to paint the game world. So in a way, this is more like the stuff I was beginning this presentation. This is actually generating a random painting. This is something that I could relate as generative art, because why that way and not that way? Why that shape and not that shape? It has some randomness to it, but here the main component of this generation, if you looked at the scenery as a painting in the end, it would be generative art, right? And instead of using a mathematical function, you are using a player. You are using free will as a random number generation. And here, this is red rope. You can see that the movement of the rope is a sort of the result of a dance between two players. It would be very similar to a wind algorithm, something like that. The way the rope behaves is very random or generative, if you will. But you can say that for mainstream games, for instance, in fighting games like Bayonetta or DMC or such, most of the combat system is pointless. Okay, like this is just it exists only for existing. Most of the way of dealing with an enemy are redundant in a way. So you are, as a player, you are dancing. You could kill that enemy in 1,000 different ways. You are actually just dancing in the air and doing all sorts of things and triggering animations between animations. But even then, you are actually not generating as much different content maybe as painting the scenery. This is also another example of pointlessness. And I'm saying pointlessness not in a derogatory way, but when you see handicraft, you see that that chair, for instance, that I showed, is very it has all those details, like the Gaudi chair. It's twisted and whatever. It's pointless. Like it is serving no function. It's not about usability. It's just there because it's there. And the Transistor is a game that, similarly to Fallout, you can play it in real time and you can play it in paused, turn-based. But you also have a lot of abilities, and in those abilities you can combine infinitely those abilities with each other. And everything here is pointless. You don't need that. You can play the game without ever opening this menu. You have a lot of ways of playing the game. And in every ability has a backstory that most people don't even know. It's a person with an opinion, with an age. The whole world is essentially pointless. But another example, to me, a big example of random generation is Assassin's Creed. And you'd think that I was going to talk about Theorester or Proteus, and when we think about art games and stuff like that, there's always these cliches, and I showed Journey, so in a way I'm using those cliches. But even in a mainstream game, you can look at this, and there's so many ways, why you could go either way, you could go on the rail. Why is he going on the rail? There's so many ways you can go from point A to point B, and so many animations that you can trigger, that in a way every playthrough is really unique. It's like a snowflake. They are very similar and they are mostly the same, but they have if you did a time lapse of every playthrough, it's very it's like a dancing, it's parkouring and dancing in a way in rooftops. And you could say, oh, but yeah, but that's the thing about parkour games. No, this is a game also by the same studio, and as you can see here, it's not the same thing. It's every element of it is in a way like a corridor. It's corridors disguised. So here you have this. You go to point A to point B. Here you can choose if you go that way or that way. It's not the same thing as what I just showed you. it's mostly like you choose wherever you want to go, but it has a different feeling. Oh, it's a thing about open worlds, you would say, because they're so big that you can generate all sorts of movement. No, actually, this is also from the same studio, and they also have parkour, and it's also an open world like Assassin's Creed. And the feeling is very different. As you can see, it's very functional. It's not as redundant, it's not as pointless as Assassin's Creed. Everything here is a way of getting to point A to point B. Of course, you can attach yourself to different things, but it's not really the same thing. And let me show you why. In this frame of Assassin's Creed, and I'm just focusing on one direction because there's a lot of waypoints, but this player wants to go there. So he can go this way, he can go, jump to this way, he can go this way, he can go this way, he can go this, like the combinations are infinite. In that moment, it could make any choice. And in this scenario, and look at how different it is from the last video I showed you, it could go this way, it could jump to this ledger, it could go this way, it could, like, it's pointless. Why is it here? It's the same thing. Why is the plate not white? This is, in a way, digital handicraft, but instead of using math, instead of using random generation through algorithms, it's using player agency. Okay, and the last thing, and actually they built a huge city with that, so it's every playthrough, as I was saying, every landscape of Minecraft is the creation of that creator. Every player that is playing in this game, and every playthrough that they make, is actually part of the big artwork that they made. Every waypoint conveys this. I was speaking about Solitaire, and another example of this is Meat Boy. And this is the last example. I've been speaking for way too long. But let's just, do you remember this? Look at this and say that it's not the same thing. So every time that you die, it records your animation. And when you finish the level, it plays all the animations. Instead of using a random generation like Solitaire, it uses player agency. So you are seeing exactly the same effect, but people are playing it, OK? Basically, every time you die, it records you. And it's the same cascading effect, but not with math, OK? So this is from everything that I've laid out. What I mean is, from everything, the future or the potential of digital artwork, if you want, is in generative art. In my opinion, I think there's a lot of potential in there, and you can see that it's a very engineering sort of ish area, so it's very unpenetrable in a way, but it doesn't have to be like that. You don't have to be a math genius to make art generation. But the next step for that is doing the opposite of AI. In AI, you're trying to make an algorithm into a subject. And in this, you are trying actually to make a subject into an algorithm. You are seeing the subject as an object. The idea is, instead of trying to make an algorithm think like a person, try instead to see a person as an algorithm. Try to use your idea of design, your language, your metaphors, to not only not force the players to do something, but give them, in a way, free will, and they could build artwork that, in a way, is your creation as well. And that concludes my talk. I'm very tired, so please be gentle. Any questions? Yeah.
So questions?
Yeah, I was going to say, a very interesting talk, and I agree with you solely on that. Like, the Minecraft-generated worlds, people, like, have their own, sort of, they build their own buildings in it as well. And the human mind's so random as well, so they could build Star Fox, they could build, well, they could destroy the world. And yeah, it's pretty interesting where that's going. And I think the industry as a whole's jumping onto Minecraft's bandwagon. So most worlds now are procedurally generated in the sandbox genre anyway, so.
Yeah, like I can see that that happening the other way around, actually, because you had sort of a few ideas like that. Minecraft is a bit of an odd example, but a few ideas like that, for instance, Spore, which tanked. But in a way, every creature was the result of player creation, right? It was user-generated content. But those ideas, like, for some reason, have failed sometimes. And I think they're going the other way, which is you don't actually create anything. You are just experiencing something for the first time very differently. For instance, you can see that the roguelike genre, which is about mixing together, and even Minecraft in a way, but which is not about creating as a user, but as experiencing always a remix. Yeah. I think it's going in that direction, which is a shame, I think. But yeah.
What can you tell me about like games who are more directed into the new technologies, like for instance, holographic games? Or where the interaction is more direct, like the player can actually almost feel himself inside the game.
So you are speaking about the input, you know, or the and the output, right? Okay. I think VR is actually right now the thing that everybody is investing in. And because you're not looking at a screen, you are actually in a physical world, and most of the VR experiences are in first person. So it would be safe to say that the focus is in immersiveness, right, and being there as you. And your brain also tells you that, because I don't know if you heard of it, but there's the thing that is called VR sickness, which is the opposite of motion sickness. In motion sickness, it moves too much and your body is still, then you want to throw up. In VR sickness, it's the opposite, which is it's not moving at all. Your body, you actually, it's a bit the opposite, but your brain is very sensitive to your body and your ears and your balance. And your brain wants you to be in first person and wants you to feel really when you are in VR. So it's not also an accident. It's actually what people want, and I would say it's what biology wants. There's people going in other routes as well, but right now you can see that as I was saying about his example, maybe it's also not the right direction, because you can see that developers, if you ask any developer, they say VR is the future. It's the next big thing. But if you ask the consumer, he doesn't know what it is and he doesn't care. For instance, PlayStation threw that out, like the PlayStation VR, and actually nobody is buying it, I guess. And even like the Gear VR of Samsung, they made a huge price, which was, I think, break-even, price for break-even or whatever. And then they dropped it because nobody was buying it, and it's really cheap right now. So if you want to see like the thing about the corridor when you are running and it's a simulation and you can feel everything. If VR succeeds, maybe it could go that way, right? But
do you think the users aren't ready for it?
I mean, there's this thing which is, and there's a nice example in Portugal about this, which is Blue Shark. They did Pokemon Go before smartphones. I'm simplifying, but it was like this Wi-Fi network thing, and you had this Nokia, and it was really weird, and you had to use Bluetooth and whatever. So they knew that mobile was going to be the next thing, and they invested a lot, and then it wasn't really a success. So there's also a thing which is, you know what the next thing is, but you are rushing it, and then you tank. I think that a lot of people jumped on the VR stuff, and there's a lot of money in it right now, and a lot of investment right now. But this and the user experience, the consumer understanding what it is and paying for it and having actually good software built upon it, it's hit or miss. It's 50-50 in my opinion. They either make that jump and there's like this big breakthrough game or whatever, or experience that people will buy VR to play it, or no, and everything falls. And if that falls, like everything else falls. If like that idea of you are immersed and then you get a shot and then you feel, this is the gateway drug in a way, this is the gateway to that. If that succeeds, then everything else will come eventually. If not, then you are stuck with your phone and your computer.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
Okay, I have one. Or rather, it's not exactly a question. It's just a reflection. I think that Isaque is exactly what we are trying to create here in a sense. Because you came here to talk about technology, but also about design. And we have an audience which is composed of designers and technologists, and this is exactly what we need. So I think that we can finish here.
Okay.
If there are no more questions. By thanking Isaque for bringing us this bridge between the two worlds, which is really necessary.
I guess. Let's finish this.